This is on a Wi-Fi. What's YouTube gonna do to me if I play this song? Probably take my stuff down. YouTube sucks.
So many things I to tell you.
Oh my.
Cause there's a possibility that you look at me differently, love. Ever since the first moment I spoke your name, from then on I knew that by you being in my life, things were destined to change. Cause love.
So many people use your name in vain.
Love, those who have faith in you
sometimes go astray. Love,
through all the ups and
downs, the joys and hurt. Love.
Your words, I if you will choose you first.
Oh,
oh. Many days I've longed for you, wanting you, hoping for the chance to get to know you, longing for your kiss.
All right, there he is. All right. Now let me get into the intro. Check one, check one. Y'all should be able to hear me, right? It's clicking. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm glad to be back with another installment. I hope you guys enjoy the background and the nice cut. Had to get right. Yep. Had to flex. But an even bigger flex is my amazingly talented guest that I have with me today. He's been the voice of Cell in the iconic Dragon Ball Z franchise, Paragos, which is Broly's father in the Dragon Ball Z franchise, South Kai, Tambourine, tons of other obscure characters that I didn't even know he voiced until I researched it. So I was like, what the fuck? he's also been the voice of Scar and Fullmetal Alchemist. Can I speak today? The voice of Handsome Jack in Borderlands. He's been on camera. He's been from Supernatural to Detective John Mumfried, I think it was his name, on How to Get Away with Murder. But anyways, let me just bring him on here so we can get him and ask these questions. So, ladies and gentlemen, can I please get a rounding roar of applause for the amazing, the immensely talented Dameon Clarke?
All right, let's go.
Dude, can you hear me?
Yeah, now I can. There we go.
Oh, jeez. I was like, I was panicking. I didn't think my mic was working or whatever. All right, cool. It's working. Great. Hi, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good, good, good. Wow, great work on the graphics, dude.
I have to come right all the time. I have to.
Are you available for banner work? Can you make me a banner?
Definitely. I do that all the time. Definitely. Yeah.
Do you?
Yeah. I do it all the time.
Yeah. Yeah. It looks great, man. I like how you got Detective Norman on there too. I was like, what the hell is that?
Had to get some of those obscure characters. If you look at the top right.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a tambourine and stuff in there. You missed, what you missed was Killa.
Who's that?
He was a boxer from like way back in the day that was like didn't speak properly because he got punched in the head too many times. But yeah, you had like some really obscure characters in there. I liked it.
Have to. But before I get into the questions, man, I would just like to say how much of an honor it is to be speaking to you today. Like, I've really grown up with you since I was a little kid, since I was like 5, which is so crazy. Which I just love doing these interviews.
It's what are you now, 15?
I'm about to be 20, so.
Oh, you actually, you are really young.
Yeah. So, but it's just.
You just graduated high school like 2 years ago.
Actually, a year ago, man.
A year ago?
Yeah.
Wow. I still have nightmares that I'm in high school and I'm 50 years old. I swear to God, it's a real dream. And I'm surrounded by other people that are not 50, but I'm in high school and I'm like, why is this taking so long? It's the worst possible dream to have. To be 50 years old and still in high school. It's absolutely.
Listen,
when like, I wake up sweating.
Yeah.
Oh, it's hell.
When absolutely I tell hell. You.
Anyway, I digress.
I had a friend, I'll put in parentheses, we didn't really talk, but he was like 18 in junior year. Like, what is going on? Like, he wasn't 18, no. I think he was about to be 20, and he was still in junior year. I was like,
"Oh my God,
you gotta go!"
That's such a nightmare.
And it's real life. It is real life. You are almost 20 and still a junior. Go, leave, leave. And he's still partying with high schoolers. And high school is definitely peak for him. I said the exact same thing. High school is peak for
Matthew McConaughey and what was that movie? What was that Richard Linklater movie? I'm drawing a blank.
I am too. Dang.
Dazed and Confused. Dazed and Confused.
Yeah.
But I remember I think I was 13 in the seventh grade. That's right. Yeah, 13 in the seventh grade. And I remember I just switched schools and I was like having a tough time adjusting, I guess. Well, and I was also shooting a lot at the time. I was filming. And I remember the vice principal pulled me aside. She said, "You're probably not going to pass the seventh grade." And I remember the panic and fear that set in, because then you're like, then you got to hang out with the younger kids the year before, and that's like the whole panic of it to this day. And I remember pulling my shit together enough to I was like, okay, I gotta like really knuckle down, because like I just wasn't doing my homework, I guess, whatever. But
oh my God. Yeah. Well, we're going to be talking a bunch. So, you know, it's going to be a great time. But the way I like to start off all my interviews recently is that, you know, with a segment I've now dubbed Off the Dome, which is where my guest starts off the interview with whatever topic they want to start with. You know, you can talk about what you just ate.
Well, I just did. It was almost not passing the seventh grade. That's how I want to start this. And my recurring nightmare of being 50 and still in high school. I really don't know what that's about. I think I should see a qualified psychologist about that.
Psychologist, yeah. Yeah. But.
But that's your answer, Jantmore. We already started off on that topic. You know what I mean?
You already know, yeah. So now let's get into the questions I really want to get to. But like, yeah, this is just such a surreal experience to me. Like I said, like one thing that I've always loved about doing these interviews and what I've been really blessed with is to speak to people that I grew up with. Like I've grown up with you since Dragon Ball Z, Dragon Ball Z Kai, Fullmetal. Like I've grown up with you, like, and just to like see you and be able to talk to you is like so.
But I don't want to talk about any of that. I want this to be a high school based interview, if you don't mind. If we could just stick with all the high school based questions, that would be
okay.
I don't want to talk about any of that stuff.
I mean,
this is going to be the worst interview you've ever had.
No, listen.
No,
because
but seriously, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No. My interviews are just for like to have fun conversations and just like getting a more in depth about the person and about their work. I mean, that's what this is all about. Just having fun. I mean, I never wanted these to be so uptight where it's just like, oh, question.
Interview, by the way? How much longer do I have to do this?
Do you have like a hard out? Oh, I forgot to ask you that. Do you have like a hard out?
I mean,
like,
I was hoping this would take maximum 5 minutes, but I'm just kidding, man. It's
hey, 5 minutes. I was going to be like, 5 minutes? I don't have enough.
Already, I'm like, how much freaking longer do I have to be here? I'm like,
no. You're just looking at the watch, Apple Watch, just like, oh, okay, next question, come on. Like,
I don't wear an Apple Watch, man. What am I, five? No, I'm going to wear a man's watch. I'm actually not wearing a watch right now. Did you play? By the way, I saw you had Detective Norman on the characters there. Did you actually play the Mafia reboot?
You know what's funny? You know what's funny? I downloaded it and I played some of it, but I don't think I got to the part where you are at. Unfortunately, I have to get back on.
Dude, I'm like from the beginning to the end. How long did you play? 10 seconds.
I didn't. Oh, really? Dang! It's been a while. Yeah. Wow, man. Yeah. But one thing I will say about that role is I love your accent. I love that. It's so good. Like, how'd you make that, by the way? How'd you create Detective Norman's, like, accent? Did you do research? Or, like, it's so cool. Well,
kind of. I mean, it's so funny because I live in Los Angeles, and I thought, you know how many Irish people, and I mean, look, let's just put it this way. If you want to find an Irish dude that's a great actor, you can find anything in LA. I mean, they exist, you know. It's like, oh, we're looking for a guy that can do a Scottish accent. Well, you can just hire somebody that's actually from Scotland. But I just remember doing the audition and then having like, I'm not really any kind of specific region or dialect. It was a sort of maybe two or three kind of mixed together, but I don't know, I guess they dug it. But I mean, I know that we did a lot of work on the coaching for it. There was a lot of time and effort that went into it ultimately, because we had to choose like a region, which was, I guess, Dublin. We went with Dublin, but yeah, it was a lot of fun to do that.
So I guess, like, cool.
Some of my family's Irish, so I just kind of pick it up here and there, you know.
Got you.
But that is so cool. I loved it.
You did mocap for that, right? Because it kind of looks like you, just a little bit, just a little.
Yeah, it's a fat, drunk version of me. So it's me, basically. What am I talking about? It's just me. It's just me. But I remember playing the game. I'm like, oh, that's what I'm going to look like in 20 years as an alcoholic.
Oh, my God.
It was fun.
No.
I didn't know what they were going to do with it. I had no idea what they were going to do with it. And I was like, holy shit, I look rough. I look so rough.
You just can tell. Yeah.
Well, you haven't seen it yet, have you? Or did you just like do the YouTube stuff?
Yeah, I looked at some clips to gain a sense of who this character is and what he's about. I haven't used some of the clips. I think I used one of the clips from the game in this edit I do for all of my guests to just let know people like, hey, we're doing this. Here's this edit. And I put like a bunch of the characters you played in it. So cool. I put them in. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I'll send it to you, but I kind of rushed on it. And like me, I'm very much a perfectionist. And like, I always critique like things.
That's
here,
what
things
I've heard about you. Yeah.
It's awful, but I can't stop it, you know. Like, so even though I think the edit is good, you'll be the judge if you want to watch it at some point. But you know,
I'm sure I'll be very. I'm already impressed with your collage work, so I'm sure I'll be very impressed.
And even
like
this,
anybody that puts more than 10 minutes of effort into anything, I'm usually very impressed with. How did you do that? How did you maintain your focus?
That's it's because I love this, you know. You know what I mean? Like, if I didn't love this, I easily would have stopped, like you said, like 10 minutes in. Like, but like, I was so zoned in and I was doing so much research on you. I was like, he's gonna know I put effort into this. Every guest needs to know I put effort into this. This isn't half assed, this isn't like, oh, I just want to talk to you. No, like, that's just me. You know, enough about me, but you know, that's what I love to do. I'm passionate about this. I love this so much, and I love doing this whenever I can. And I want my guests to know that, hey, you know, I care about you. Here's this artwork. Here's this edit. Here's this poster. Boom, doing the whole nine yards.
Do you ever watch Hot Ones?
Yes. Yes, I have. Yep.
That guy's a really good. What's his name? The interviewer?
I have to look at. Hold on. Let me look.
He is a dynamite interviewer because he dives so deep into his guests that he comes up. I think every guest that he has on says that's a great question at least once, because he takes the time and he takes the effort to not ask just bullshit, you know, questions like what's it like to be an actor or you know whatever. No offense if that's one of your questions.
Oh no! Listen,
But he's like he's such a good interviewer, you know.
Yeah, and I take a lot of inspiration. His name is Sean Evans. I just looked it up on my phone. Sean Evans. And I take a lot of inspiration from people like that who are dedicated about their craft and are really passionate, so I can really hone my skills.
It makes all the difference, yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It really does. And I remember when – I don't know if you know who this is, but it's a legendary voice actor, voiceover artist. I'm sure maybe you've heard of him once, but Corey Burton. Have you heard of him before?
Oh, my God. I thought for sure I would know who you're talking about, and I don't. But I know I do, but the name is not ringing a bell. What do I know him from? Probably everything.
Yeah, I was about to say, you know, he's been the voice of Captain Hook from the Peter Pan movie since like 1978. He's the voice of Count Dooku in the Star Wars TV shows and video games, if you watch that stuff.
That's right.
Yeah, Cad Bane, if you watch the Book of Boba Fett, he was in that. He was the voice of Cad Bane. He's really everywhere. Awesome.
And legend.
Legend. And he said to me that I love your professionalism and I love what you bring to the table as an interviewer. And he said to me, like, I don't really do a lot of interviews because they ask like dry, like blah, blah, blah. And I remember just blushing mid-interview and he was just like, you don't do that. I was like, stop. And I was like, ducked my head down like in embarrassment because it's just like, what the fuck? You know, this is really cool.
You're really patting yourself on the back here, aren't you?
No, okay. I'm sorry. I don't mean to do that. Okay. No,
I'm just kidding. Look, I'm only halfway through this thing right now, so my verdict's still out on you, but I'm sure it's going to be fine.
Okay. are you filming something right now?
I'm working on a project right now that they got us, you know, NDA'd up the ass for. But other than that, I'm just doing a lot of conventions right now. It's great because, I started recording / I guess filming last couple of weeks. We're still we just finished rehearsals and I guess officially started filming last week. So I'll be on that for probably another two, hopefully three weeks.
Oh, yeah.
And then just got some dates coming up from cons, which is great because that's finally opening back up again. I mean, it was a real drag sitting on, as everybody knows, you know, locked up and sitting on your ass for 2 years, right? 2 years. It's crazy. But, you know, we're back, man. We're back. And everyone's got such a thick skin now because of it. It's like World War III. They're like, you can't mess with anybody now. They're just like, look, man, everyone's just numb, it feels like, you know? Oh, gas is $10 a gallon? Whatever. You know, I don't care anymore. A gallon of milk's 10 bucks? Fucking. But I mean, the cool thing is that people are getting back, you know, the con world is reviving and people are able to get out and talk to each other and not just message each other and, you know, reunite. And it's great. I love it.
Coming to Georgia?
Georgia? I think so.
You have to tell me. You have to tell me.
Hang on. When is it?
You do have one in Georgia? I don't know if you do.
I've got a bunch. Hang on a second. Hang on.
Oh, he dipped out. Sorry, Alpha. It's like I'm looking at two screens. Sorry.
Okay, well, I was going to check my calendar, but I think I'm going to go away on you if I do. I'm pretty sure I've got Georgia coming up. Can you Google it real quick and just see is there a con coming up in Georgia? I'm telling you, it's like right in the back of my head. I think there is one coming up.
Hold on. There's this website I did not know. What's it called? What's it start with?
Well, I don't know. I think I'm going to South Carolina in a couple of weeks, and then a couple of weeks after that, I'm going to Vegas for Fanboy.
Okay, so I'm looking at them right now. There's okay, Fanboy Expo Las Vegas is April 22nd to the 24th. Then you go into one in Canada, May 21st through the 22nd. And those are the only ones you have on this convention.
You know, it's funny because I didn't know about the Canada one. Are you serious? Wait a minute. What's that one called?
That one
I'm dead serious.
Maybe this is wrong, then, because it says you're going to be at Comic-Con Revolution.
I know that we were talking about Canada, but I didn't know. Oh, my God, my agents. Okay, well, I'll look into that. What's it called?
It's called Comic-Con Revolution Ontario 2022.
Okay. What month?
That will be May 21st through the 22nd.
May 21st to the 20th. Okay. Interesting.
This might be right. Hey, if you don't know it, then this might be wrong. I ain't gonna lie.
Well, the thing, who knows with Canada? You know what I mean? Canada's lost its mind. There's seizing people's bank accounts. There's trucks blocking the road. I mean, who knows? There's red zones. There's green zones. There's blue zones. That, you know, I'm Canadian, and I gotta tell you, man, like it is crazy how much Canada has lost its mind.
Oh my goodness. It's nuts. Watching it on the news has been just so interesting to unfold to see just everything there, you know, because it's like people are like, Canada is the good side. Then like you see all this news, you're seeing stuff like they're finding, what was it? It was a while ago. They were like, they found a school and they were like, remains of like, you know, ancient civilizations that they had killed just like casually under a school. Like, I don't know what's going on. It's insane.
I didn't know about that.
Yeah.
They were like raiding churches and stuff like that during COVID and arresting people for gathering for like, you know, so they can, I don't know, whatever their denomination was, they were gathering to pay heed. And the cops were like SWAT teams and stuff, just crazy shit. The stuff that you would never expect from some dudes on horses, you know, like the Mounties.
The Mounties. That's what you think with the Canadian, like the big old hat on the horse.
Dudley Do Right.
Exactly. Right. You said it for me.
Dudley's not doing anything cool these days, man. He's
not doing anything right.
No, man. But anyway, thanks for the heads up on that. I'll check it out.
Canada. Yeah, definitely. If it's wrong, I will tell all of you. I'll put it in the comment section.
Hang on a second. I'm going to go dark for a minute. Let me check my calendar here. Hang on.
Atlanta Comic-Con. My back hurts already. I'm getting old, y'all. I am getting old. What is going on? My back is hurting. And it's a mess. Da-da-da. I love how I got this man looking up conventions.
Greenville, South Carolina, that's what it is.
Okay.
So that's on like the 8th, and then I go to Vegas after that.
Okay.
And then, I got some other ones coming up, California and whatnot. Anyway, the Con World's back more or less. So that's awesome. I'm very happy for everybody, really. Because I guess, you know, like I was saying, it was people going crazy. Not being able to travel, not being able to do anything. You know, what my reaction, my first reaction was with the whole Ukraine crisis was, this better not screw up domestic travel, I swear to God. If we can't fly or do anything again because of like, it's so crazy that my first thought with us being on the brink of World War III is they better not lock us up in our homes. Like, never mind the end of civilization, just, you know.
But I mean, shoot, with these gas prices, we might as well stay inside. I don't know. You know what I mean? Like,
dude, I tell you what, I'm not going anywhere. I'm like, mm-mm. It's $7 here right now, almost.
It's $4 here. I know California is insane. I think I don't know how y'all live in California. I can't do it. I know I'm going to have to move there eventually for like acting and stuff.
Dude, it's bonkers. You don't need to come out here. Don't do that. I've been trying to get out of here for 20 years, man. It's a dumb state. It's a dumb, stupid state to live in. It's always just trying to repair itself, and it's perpetually bankrupt, and it's got bozos like Gavin Newsom running the. It's a sinking ship. It has been forever. It's stupid. You can't afford anything. There's no future here. Not that I want to really be so bleak and horrible about it, but you know, I've been here long enough. It's like I want to go somewhere normal. And when something like a pandemic hits, you realize just how silly it is here. It's just silly.
Right. It's interesting to see what's going on all over the place, man. But I'm just glad that I always got to keep the hope in a lot of these situations where it's like, definitely always got to keep the hope and that light that we're gonna get out, because I mean, there's been so many situations, you know, that have happened worldwide, or just, you know, we could even look at ourselves in situations where it's like, oh, we've been in situations where it's like it's done, it's finito, but it's like we've made it out on the other side. So as me, as someone who likes to look at it optimistically,
you're 20.
You
do have to be optimistic, absolutely, because then it's just, you know, you throw yourself off of a balcony. I mean, what are the options, right? You have to be positive about things. But also, I like to encourage people to get familiar with history. I don't know. Do they really, like, how much do they harp on history in high school these days? Like, because that's really the thing that sort of I think people are lacking. Like, do they really hit on it as much as they used to when I was a kid?
Yeah, I mean, like, we're supposed to take it, and I'm in college right now, community, so I just finished world history, so
it's all cyclical, right? It all comes back around. Like, the shit we're doing now that we're doing in the 1500s or the 1600s, it's all cyclical.
Yeah, who said that to me? I was talking to a friend, and they were like, this shit just happens in circles, cycles, and I'm just like,
yeah.
It does.
Yeah, you would think in 2022 that we're sort of like covering new ground and forging ahead and doing things that haven't been done before. But in a lot of ways, like, we are doing stuff that we were doing back in the 1200s, you know, like just crazy dumb stuff. It's interesting to see, I mean, without getting into it too much, but it's interesting to see just how much history does repeat itself. But yeah, you got to be positive about it and just realize that, you know, all of this, if anything, your generation's got to know that this, all this shit can go away just like that. You know, well, I didn't have that growing up when there was no pandemic. There was nothing to put us in check like that. There was the Cold War, but that wasn't, you know what I mean? Like, that was the biggest thing that we had going on. With your generation now, it's, I mean, how many things?
That's what I'm saying. We have a mini Cold Wars, and we have gas prices, then we still have COVID, then we have like all of this. It's like, what's happening? I saw a meme where someone's like, I'm tired of living through historical events. I completely agree.
That's true. It's so true. Everything's precedent setting right now. Everything's fucking melting, right? You know, the coastlines were, I mean, I just, again, without getting into it too much, but it's so crazy that you guys are living like all of these insane precedent setting, life changing events at once. There's like five huge things going on right now. So God bless you.
You guys are the
guys that are gonna change all this, man. But I'm glad that you have a positive attitude about stuff, because you have to, for sure.
Definitely, I love spreading that around to just help people as much as I can with that, because, you know, I feel like that's a lot of things that needs to be more in society. It's just more like, you know, it's more love and just more caring for one another. I feel like a lot of times people are just so nonchalant and just so like cold to one another, especially during times like this. I find it so important to just be kind and be that light for a lot of people through their dark times, because it's extremely important. Like you said, when we're going through stuff like this, it's just important to be there for people like that. So I definitely love doing that too. So hope everyone does that to themselves and their thing. Absolutely. Look at us too. Yeah. I'm here trying to talk. I was going to talk to you about Dragon Ball Z, but we're having a whole philosophical conversation.
Gotcha.
No, I love it, man.
This is gonna be normal. No, I'm just kidding. Ask your Dragon Ball Z questions.
But So you know, but one question I was gonna ask, the first question I was gonna ask is, how would you describe, you know, sort of your childhood upbringing and how it's affected you, especially going into the acting industry?
Hey, great question. Wow, you're really good at this. Yeah, high five. That wasn't joking. You know, it's funny, actually. No, you are good at this. I grew up weird. I grew up on the base of a mountain called Mount Seymour in a place called Woodlands, which was like an old logging community. Population of, I honestly don't know, like 50 people maybe. And then we had to take a boat to school every morning to and from.
Hold on, wait. What? A boat?
Yeah, man. It was what? Like some serious Lord of the Flies shit. I was like feral until I was like 13. I don't know how. I'm not normal by any stretch, but I'm more normal than I thought it would be, considering. No, you know what? It's not Lord of the Flies. It was Huck Finn. It was Huck Finn minus the horrible racism. It was so weird, man. Taking a boat back and forth and just all the kids. You know, when I think back on it, it was wild. And you know, there's like mountain lions and bears and stuff everywhere. It's a miracle that I wasn't eaten at some point. Then when we were like 13, I think we moved to a city, West Van. And then my sister was dating an actor, and he got me into acting when I was like around 12 or 13.
Wow.
And that's that, you know.
And it's just been like, I know while I was researching, I found out this was pretty interesting, is that you took a sabbatical from acting for a little bit to focus on your studies, which is just really.
Well, I told you that I almost failed out of school because I was shooting so much. And I was kind of like, oh, I mean, yeah, I had like tutors and stuff, but the tutor I had, I don't think was very good. She just didn't give a shit. But I remember being on set and like having tutors and stuff like that. And then I was just, and you know what, when you're a kid and you're on set for 13 hours a day, dude, it's not fun. It just isn't. It's a job. It's one giant timeout for a kid. You just sit in a corner and wait to be called. So it was kind of torture. And so then I put it down for years and years and years, and then did a lot of things, that are behind the scenes. I was an assistant director for a number of years and a talent agent for a while, and you know, sort of getting a pretty broad education in the film and TV world, and then got back into acting like around, I'd say, 28, 29.
Wow, damn. So with that happening, what was the feeling of returning to acting after being away from it for so long? Was it like second nature to you? Did you look at it differently with a different lens now? What was that like?
Different lens for sure. Because when you spend as much time on set behind the camera ADing as I did, which I mean, actually it's not that much, but enough for me to really get a handle on what goes into making this all happen and what the role of an actor is and all that. Because I mean, if you're just an actor, and you don't have any concept of what goes into making a production happen, you can be self-centered. You can be like, this is all about me. And it's really not. Like, you're really far down on the pecking order of things. And it's your job, unless you're Cate Blanchett or whatever, number one, number two on the call sheet, and you're driving that vehicle along with the writers and the producers and the directors. Those are the helmsmans of the ship. You're just there to sort of, as a team player, to make this happen and to make this work. It's a lot of actors that just don't understand that. And
absolutely.
That's why actors get a bad rap. A lot of actors get a bad rap. People can be like, what do you do for a living? And you say you're an actor, you just hear people's eyes roll. Because there's a lot of people that get into it for the wrong reasons. There's, you know, I want to be famous. I want to be able to get a table at a restaurant right away. Whatever your fucking deal is. But it's, you know, you hear about it all the time. But if you work on set in a behind the scenes production capacity, I was a production assistant for a couple of years, you really understand what it takes to make it all work. And it's humbling. So, yeah.
Absolutely.
That's why I try not to be a pain in the ass about stuff. You know what I mean? So I'm like, no, I'm good. Don't worry about it. Get my own coffee, man. I'm good, you know?
Right. Don't get the guy. I'll just get up and, you know, I score my way to the machine. Ooh. Yeah, definitely. And that's what's something I've appreciated with what me and my friends are doing, is that we're making our own short films, making our own films, and we're acting and doing our own thing,
right,
our own productions. And yeah, absolutely. And it's just been so amazing to get a full understanding working with my friends about script writing or camera angles or different cameras or color grading and how important that is, or scoring. One of my best friends is a phenomenal composer. I really could see him like scoring a big bunch
of right on.
So good at it. And it's just amazing watching pieces of the puzzle come together to make everything what it is. So definitely has been something that
it's always
I don't
good to know a composer, that's for sure.
Yeah, and one of the best, man. If I'll send you some of this stuff, he's so good. But that's just something that I really applaud you for getting the education on that. That reminds me of, I don't know if you know who this music producer is. His name is Swizz Beatz. He's worked with people like Drake and a ton of these other phenomenal musical artists that have just will stand the test of time. But he took a break away from producing and making music to get a business sense of the music industry and to know what goes into it and making stuff like that and understanding sort of what you did. Because he was like, hey, I need this education to fully appreciate and understand what's going on to know.
Well, the music business is just, I mean, navigating those waters is either as treacherous, if not more so than film and TV. Because, I mean, if you're going to get screwed over, it's going to be in the music business. So good for him. That's smart. Yeah. You know, I don't know if you listen to Joe Rogan at all, but he had Jewel on. And Jewel was talking about how, like, coming up in the business and, like, how it's a really fascinating interview because she was actually very savvy in how she put her deal together and navigating the film, the music business. Without getting into it too much, I highly recommend listening to that interview.
Yeah, and let's not even get into the record labels and how they will screw you over royally. Let's not even talk about that, because I see so much of the time these artists are going broke or saying they can't, they're not making their
money. Save your money.
Save it. If y'all want to take away one thing from this interview, save your money. Save it, because that is
wisely. Do you remember Cypress Hill? You ever listen?
Yes! To Cypress Hill? Oh my God!
You remember Rock Superstar or Rap Superstar? That song is all about the business and save your money, man. But yeah, they're both businesses. You're just a commodity. Nobody gives a shit about you, but they will always make you. That's why so many people are so disenfranchised and bitter about the entertainment industry, music included, is because, you know, it's human nature to want to believe that somebody likes you or somebody finds value in you, because that's human nature. But both of those businesses are set, you're a commodity. So both of those businesses are set up to make you believe that you're loved and wanted, when in fact you're actually just a paycheck. And as soon as you're not a paycheck, you're out the fucking door. And it's hard. It's hard as a human being to come to that realization, and also to go through that because you gotta be pretty seasoned to understand that, you know, when your agent calls you up and they're like, hey, he was my favorite guy. You know what I mean? Hey, they're like, oh yeah, I guess this guy's my buddy. No, he's not your buddy. You're making money for that person right now, and they only care about it. So that's why it's such a brutal business to when you're taking human relationships and reducing them to numbers and paychecks and spreadsheets and things like that. It's, you know, you're a number. It's tough. So that's why when you ask an actor or anybody in the music business, hey, I want to be an actor. No one that's been doing it for a long time is going to go, that's a great idea. Especially if you're a parent, you're just not. I don't know anybody that's ever said that. Even Tom Hanks will probably tell his kids, please, Colin, don't be an actor. And that's with my name. That's with the Hanks name. Right? I mean, because you love your kids. You don't want them to go through that shit. Anyway.
I don't want them to get hurt. Yeah, and that's like, that could just lead it to a whole other interesting conversation about how parents even use their kids just for money in this nasty,
devil. Yeah.
Ugh, dirty. You see it all the time. I hate it. And then you just see these actors, these child actors grow up and they're just, something's not right, because they've been through this industry that, like you said, oftentimes will take advantage of you and will look at all you, like time. You said, like you're a number, like you're a all paycheck. And to have to grow through that when you're growing up and learning and trying to come into yourself as a kid is heartbreakingly sad. And that's
That was another thing about being a kid actor too, was being on set for 2-3 months at a time sometimes, and then having this family. There and everybody, all the actors that you're working with, the adults and stuff, you're the children of the adult and the thing, and then they're treating you like, you know, like you're this special person. And as soon as wraps up, you know, you're done and you don't talk to those people anymore. And as a kid, it's really hard, because it's like, well, where do those people go? Like, I have a relationship with them. They're my friends. They're not. They're gone. You'll never see them again. They didn't give a fuck about you. They just needed to do that to get through the shoot. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I'm just saying that's reality of it, right? As a kid, it's really hard. So I agree with you. Like, you putting a child in that environment where it's you know, I think you get used to very quickly protecting yourself and then not putting these walls up around yourself. And so as an adult, good luck making relationships happen, you know?
Oh my God. Like, look, let's oh, this is a really good interview. I'm liking this a lot. I was just yeah, and that's what I love, the deep conversations. And yeah, I could only imagine what that's like. I see that in people who haven't gotten into the entertainment industry, who have had to harden themselves up because of dealing with childhood trauma, or they went through a really bad breakup, and it's just hard for them to get out of that sort of mindset that they've been coddled and grew up in, to grow out of that, to foster healthy and aiding relationships. Because you, like you said, you've had to close yourself off in a sense to really protect your own peace in an industry where, like you said, you are a number. So
Hey dude, I got about 10% left on the phone here. I kind of screwed up, but I didn't charge it. I'm only telling you that so if you've got some things that you do want to cover, let's do it, because I've totally derailed you. So
would you like to come back for a part two at some time?
Sure.
All right, cool. Yeah, so I'll get to these questions really fast, and then
yeah, I know we kind of got off track there. Sorry, yeah, I didn't charge my phone properly, but I don't know.
No, you're perfectly fine. It's all right. It happens. I really enjoyed this, but so gotta talk about Dragon Ball Z. I can't leave here without talking about my favorite villain of all time, Cell. Love Dragon Ball Z.
Yes, hello. Yeah. You're welcome. Yes.
Ah, I love that. Oh, I love that so much. Get the chills all the time. But
I love
do
that
you...
reaction. That's awesome.
You'll see it a lot when voice actors do their voices, or actors do like their character. I'll just like jump out of my seat.
Oh, I love it. I get this kick out of it.
But do you remember the audition process for Cell? Did you see the character first, or was he described to you? Okay.
Yeah, well, I did, but it was only the first version. I had no idea there were two others. Funimation back in the day was not what it is now. and they, I don't know, just didn't mention that to me. So I saw this kind of sneaky, kind of lizardy kind of dude. And then I thought, oh, let's make that as creepy as possible. And so I was kind of shooting for a Exorcist vibe there. Sort of like that, you know. You ever see The Exorcist?
I've not watched it, but I've seen. I'm too scared. I'm a scaredy cat, to be honest. I don't watch horror movies.
It's a terrifying movie, but that's kind of the vibe I was going for. That Linda Blair kind of, and then I didn't realize there was another two. So I kind of, it's like, oh, what am I going to do with that? So I auditioned for the first version of it, and they said, okay, there you go. So they didn't audition me for all three, but you know, it worked out. I love that character. It's awesome.
I know you came back to do him for Dragon Ball Z Kai. How did you guys record Dragon Ball Z Kai? I've always been curious about this because I noticed. Obviously, but I mean, like, how did you guys record it, like, as a group, or was it soloed? Because I know a lot of times with anime, you're filling in lip flaps. Yeah. So
it's not. ADR anime. It's all sort of you're by yourself. It's not what's called prelay, where it's they draw. You do the voice and then they draw it afterwards. Yeah, that's the opposite in this case.
Well, so you got to see like Christopher Sabat and Sean Schemmel and the rest of those guys.
Yeah, I don't really. Those names ring a bell, but I'm not. Who's Chris Sabat again?
He's Vegeta. And Piccolo and.
This guy. Deep voice, kind of a funny dude.
Yeah.
You know, I was kidding. I love Chris. He's awesome.
I was like, what the heck? You always throw me for loops, man. I'm like, what's going on?
We're still more. Please excuse the dad humor, honestly. We're still in touch. I mean, as much as we can be, because I'm in California and those dudes are in Texas. But I mean, I love those guys to death. I'm actually going to see Eric in Vegas coming up.
Wow.
We're still talking, you know.
Yeah. It's, well, I know your phone is about to give way, so I'm gonna let you get off.
Do a part two? I'll do a part two with you.
Yeah, definitely. We could do that. Just I'll let you just let me know, and we'll go at it.
How long have we been talking for?
44 minutes.
Oh well, shit! It's not like I ripped you off time wise. I mean,
saying. Yeah, no.
I gave you 40 minutes. Thought of more than I thought I was going to. So that's.
Oh yeah, no. So yeah, definitely, man. Yeah, I would love to bring you back on and just talk more. I really love your personality and I love your energy, and that's another reason I wanted to bring
you
on.
Thanks, buddy. Right back at you, man.
Yeah, sure. I just really love your energy, and it's just so like funny and chill, and it's like really like not like high up, like kind of like you got your guns up at me, like I don't know you. It's kind of just like, oh, chill, I'm talking to you. You know, I love that. I've always loved that energy about you.
So, well, you know, I've been doing it for a while now, and I really enjoyed the interview because it was just, you know, talking about real stuff. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
I mean, yeah, cover the work and things like that. But I mean, I think when you're interviewing people, it's always good, fun to kind of get to know the person, right?
Absolutely. Oh, I love that. Yeah. So, all right. Well, yeah. Part two, guys, yeah, coming soon. Dameon, thank you so much for joining me. I will see you next time.
Absolute pleasure.
Absolutely. So you have a great rest of your day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, brother. Talk to you soon, man.
Talk to you soon. Bye.
Bye.